Hey guys, welcome back. Today in part two, we're going to continue our discussion of the male coif. So in this video, we're going to continue our discussion of coifs, and it's going to be kind of framed around some of the information in Lindy Beige's video on coifs. If you guys haven't seen that, there'll be a link in the description below. Now, I'm a big fan of Lindy Beige. This isn't an attack on his channel or anything like that. But on that particular video, I think some of the arguments were a little bit confusing or oversimplified, and I want to offer an alternative interpretation of what we might be seeing in the imagery of the Morgan Bible, and kind of offer perspective on the interpretation of biblical imagery in medieval manuscripts in general, to maybe kind of clarify some of the things that were said in that video. So the first thing I want to talk about is male as a primary defense for the head. I agree that male is not adequate as a primary defense for the head. The difference that I have from what Lindy Beige says is how we interpret those visual sources. So when we look at the Morgan Bible, there are a number of examples where you see a male coif being worn with a helmet on over the male coif, great helm, nasal helm, whatever, and that helmet is acting as the primary defense for the head. That makes perfect sense. But there's also a huge number of depictions of warriors in the Morgan Bible, the Masejowski Bible, whatever you want to call it, where the what appears to be the primary defense for the head is simply the male coif. And, well, if that's inadequate protection, what's going on here? And it seemed to drive Lindy Beige to the conclusion that, well, the visual evidence is just not good. We should dismiss what we see here. It doesn't really make sense. And there must be a whole hell of a lot more padding underneath there to make the male an adequate primary defense. And I think that was the wrong way to go. I think there's a much simpler explanation, and that can be found in a lot of the other folios in the Morgan Bible. There are a number of depictions within the Morgan Bible of people wearing a full hauberk with an integrated coif, except the coif is in the position where it's doffed over the shoulders off the head. And in many of the cases, what we see in those particular images is that the individual is still protected by a cervelier, which in this case would be the innermost layer, with the exception of a possible padded arming cap. A cervelier, for those who are unfamiliar with it, is basically a very form-fitted, very small skull cap of iron that basically only protects the cranium, the top of the head. If we look at those images and you imagine that that's the innermost layer, and then you take that coif and you draw it up over the cervelier and secure it in place with that band that's depicted on a lot of the those particular warriors, all of a sudden it looks from the outside like they're basically only wearing a coif with a substantial amount of padding in there, but what's really going on is there's likely an iron cervelier acting as the primary defense for your skull. It's also, of course, worth mentioning that there are many depictions of the coif, the attached coif, being doffed off where you don't see a cervelier on top of the arming cap. Instead, you just see an arming cap. In those particular cases, I think it would be the most likely solution that once the coif is on, then a separate helmet is being worn, even though one is not explicitly depicted in the imagery laying about on the ground or anything like that. But when it comes to the case of only seeing a male coif as what appears to be the only external protection for the head, I think what's really going on there is that you have a cervelier on the inside of the coif being worn over. And in other imagery, we see that it's not uncommon to wear helmets underneath a coif, and that's where you get some of these kind of crazy shapes of people's heads and things like that. And I think that's what's going on here in the Morgan Bible. The second thing I want to talk about is the kind of odd, awkward grain changes in the male and the tucks that you see in the male. And again, when looking at those, Lloyd kind of went to the conclusion of, well, how much can we really trust this stuff anyway? I think there are two ways to interpret what's going on here. The first and the simplest explanation is what you're seeing is the way that the ventail changes the grain of the male. If you imagine that ventail being drawn across the face and secured up to the top, the grain of that ventail is going to be relatively perpendicular to the grain of the rest of the coif. When we look at more detailed imagery from about the same time period, like the Westminster Psalter, you can see that band through the head is helping keep the coif securely in place, but it's also serving as an anchor point for the thong that's securing the ventail, and it creates that tuck in the male that we see often in the Morgan Bible and a lot of other sources from the time period. The other way to interpret this, which I also find very compelling and interesting, is that coifs are made in different ways, and we see a lot of depictions of coifs where it looks like the grain of the male forms like a circle around the face, which would result in vertical kind of grain going over the top of the head and then coming back down the other side. But how do we get that sudden change of grain on the top of the head? Well, we can dismiss the Morgan Bible, of course, or we can look at a lot of other sources and sculpture like the Saint Maurice statue, where we see that same thing, that kind of circular grain around the face and then that abrupt change in grain around the top of the head. We also see it in this statue from the Louvre, where you have that sudden change in grain at the top of the head as compared to the face, and a number of artistic sources beyond the Morgan Bible which show the same thing. So let's suppose here for a minute, Lloyd did mention this in his video, he kind of asked the question, is this supposed to be two pieces of mail? And yes, I think that's exactly what it's supposed to be. If we go back to some earlier sculptures, you can see here that there is a depiction of a male coif on this effigy, where you get that same circular grain pattern around the face, but it carries over the entire head like we would expect to see if it was just one singular piece. Suppose that particular style of construction were paired with what's known as a coiffette. Well, a coiffette, if you can't tell from the name, the diminutive of coif, it's basically a little coif. And that is just a section of mail that's worn on the top of the head. And we have some later examples, later survivals of these. But if you were to take that male coiffette and you were to pair it with that particular construction of coif and wear it over top, well, the visual result of that would basically be that abrupt grain change of mail that we see in so many of the visual sources of the time period. And all of that kind of combines into my third point, which is biblical imagery in general. He kind of concludes his video with looking at the plate of David and Goliath and then saying, well, this is a Bible, so everything's kind of made up anyway, and tries to kind of cast doubt on the material culture that we see. And I don't think that's really a good way to go about trying to express what's happening in medieval depictions of biblical images. So we can argue all day about whether or not the stories in the Bible are real, or if they're based on history, or if they're not. But that's entirely beside the point in the way that medieval Bibles represented the material culture, and specifically the armor and clothing that are being shown. There are depictions of what we would refer to as them trying to show the other, or like exotic pieces of armor or Romans or things like that. But when they're trying to convey to an audience that largely needs visuals to understand what's going on, because they may not necessarily be able to read what's going on, they have to do it in a way that shows people what they're used to seeing. And that means that in order to show that Goliath is a soldier, they put him in the typical kit of a soldier of that particular time period, that particular time period being when the Morgan Bible was penned. So he's wearing a kettle hat. He's wearing a male hauberk. He's wearing gamboised cuisses and shinbalds. Those are not atypical things of a mid to late 13th century professional soldier. Whereas David is depicted as a peasant. He's wearing his kind of gown and he's got his sling and his club so that people know he's a shepherd. He's a peasant. He's not a typical soldier. And this isn't just some peculiar convention in the Morgan Bible. As we go to different biblical sources in different time periods and different locations in the Middle Ages, what we see is that they're all using that convention of showing people, showing their audience the typical kit of that time period so that they can properly visually interpret what they're looking at in the illuminations. All right, guys, thanks for watching. I hope that was enjoyable. Hopefully that gave you some perspective, offer a different viewpoint on how you might interpret those images from the Morgan Bible and other biblical sources in general. If you like the video, please give me a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already, and we'll see you in the next one. Thank you very much for watching.